Hey, good morning.
Hey, Jeff, how's it going?
Good, things are good. How do you pronounce your first name? Is it Mateusz?
Mateusz.
Mateusz, sorry about that. Hey, Mateusz, how are you?
Good, good.
Good, thanks for reaching out. So we got 15 minutes, so let's get right to the, you know, the pressing stuff that's most important on the priority list.
Okay. Just to make it quick, basically my parents have a five-year-old lab. His name's Oscar, and they also have an eight-month-old puppy named Charlie. My girlfriend and I have a four-month-old pitbull puppy, and okay. The issue is that the five-year-old lab, he's, I guess, we would consider dog-human aggressive.
Right.
He lunges at strangers, at dogs.
Okay. Has he got into a fight at all with breaking skin?
No, not that we've known of. I know my parents took him for a walk once, and some little dog tried to attack him, and he just kind of, like, pushed him away with his head. He's never attacked, like, I've had friends over, he would never attack them, he'd kind of just lunge at them,
okay.
And then walk away.
Okay.
The thing is, it's hard for me to, because my girlfriend and I, we live an hour and a half away, and we like to come home on the weekends, but it's tough, because it's such a stressful thing. We don't know what he's going to do to the puppy. We don't know if he's going to bite him or just, you know, bark at him.
Right, right.
So, I don't know in what way to introduce them. I mean, when my parents got the eight-month-old puppy, I know that it took a week and a half for them to get used to each other with, like, 24-hour supervision.
Yeah.
And now they're best friends, but I don't have that time to introduce them for a week and a half.
No, you don't.
So, yeah. Just looking for any kind of advice.
All right. So what kind of, so the big thing is this is, you know, the dog that's doing the lunging, the older dog that's doing the lunging, what kind of lifestyle does it have? What kind of structure? Like, it's always hard when you're dealing with like your folks or like relatives or stuff like that. And the biggest thing is, are they open to this? Are they interested in helping you out?
It's difficult. No, there isn't any structure. My parents kind of got the dogs and they just let them do whatever the hell they want.
Yeah.
I did introduce them to the idea of the prong collar. At first, they were a little skeptical, but my father eventually got one and he's using it.
Yeah.
And he's walking by his side. He's not pulling him anymore.
There you go. Well, there you go. Right.
Yeah, so that was one thing. My mom, not so open. So that's the difficult thing.
Okay. So she's okay. Yeah. She's okay with this dog lunging at humans and lunging at dogs, and scaring your neighbors. But she's not okay with keeping the dog calm and obedient.
That's the problem. It's,
right.
If everyone was on the same page, it'd be a lot easier. But
it's really hard. So
yeah.
So the thing is the act of it sounds like the dog is just badly behaved. It's possibly not aggressive. It's just badly behaved. There has to be a point where when this dog does something that's dangerous, such as like, this is the thing, it can really mess up your puppy. Your parents' dogs, let them do what they want to do with it. If they want their dog to be the bully of the neighborhood, that's on them. But my big concern, since theoretically now, you know, you're the one, you know, looking for help, 4 months old, 16 weeks, you know, that dog can lunge at your dog, and if your dog has a bad experience, that can and does turn your dog into a reactive dog. And the theory is that dogs are dangerous. Dogs are dangerous. So, I mean, just think about it from any other standpoint. If you know, you lived in, if you walked down the street and every time you saw a person, they walked up to you and pushed you or hit you or yelled at you or screamed you, and that happened, you know, 2 to 3 times a day, and eventually you would think, geez, people are really mean and awful, and that's what they do. So eventually you would be proactive. And that's probably what's going to happen to the puppy. So then your options are, do you have your own separate room when you stay at your folks' house on the weekends?
Yeah, I have my bedroom. That's what, for the past month, I've been doing, just keeping him in my bedroom.
You keep him in the bedroom, you take the dog out, you go for structured walks, you do some, do you have a fenced-in yard? It's your folks.
Yeah.
All right.
That's the biggest thing.
You do it when you're with the other dogs inside. You know. Again, this is not the answer. Like, this isn't going to fix the problem. But I'm more concerned about you and your dog you know, I, put it this way, I'd rather you call me on this than you call me 4 months from now saying my dog's dog reactive. So you put some structure into your dog at their house. You run around the backyard. It, you know, you play frisbee, play tug, play chuck it. You do some obedience commands. You go. Then you put the dog back in the bedroom. I mean, that's not. I don't want to say that's not training, but you know, your dog will be fine over the weekend if it's, you know, out of the crate for an hour, into the crate for 4 hours, out of the crate for an hour. It'll be fine. It'll be fine. You know. And you know, how do you introduce? So that's what I would do if I had a, if I had one party that was not open to the concept of their dog not attacking my dog. I'd be like, either I'm not going, I'm not bringing my dog over there anymore, which is not probably the answer. I'm not going over there anymore, which is probably not the answer. Or I'm gonna keep the dog in my bedroom. So yeah. And for me, like when I travel, okay, my dogs will stay in the RV. That's fine. I do enough stuff with my dogs. I don't need my dog to be to have that thrown at them because I want to advocate for my dog. Now, how do you introduce them? Well, you I prefer to do it off leash. You know, you'd have to know that this dog was not aggressive. How do you know if a dog's not aggressive? If it's been around dogs, maybe it's been barking and lunging and being a bully, but it's never broken skin. But I don't want it chasing around your puppy and having your puppy hide underneath, you know, bushes and tables and everybody just standing around saying, oh, let them figure it out. It says, no, we figured out. You know, the bottom line is the bully, which is your folks dog, has to be stopped and stopped right now. How do you do that? You do that with a remote collar. You can do that with a dressage whip. If you've ever seen us like do socialization with a dressage whip. So one quick, again, you're not, it's not a whipping action. It's just a tap, tap on the butt action. The reason why we can have 20 dogs in an area, it's not because they're afraid of being, you know, punished. And they're not like afraid of the whip. They don't move away from the whip at all because they understand and they're all calm and they're not afraid of staff and they're not afraid of dogs. But they obviously know that if they do any sort of dominant behavior, dominant posturing, aggressive behavior, pre-aggressive behavior, they're going to be told in a very calm manner that's not acceptable. And that's what tools allow you to do. Tools allow you, when you've got a dog that's, say, 20 feet away, and that dog starts looking like it's going to be, you know, pre-aggressed towards your puppy, a remote collar can just say, not today. And you know, you don't have to yell, you don't have to scream. You could say no, and then boom. You can start instilling the word no into the dog. So no, and then consequence, which is uncomfortable. Then the dog will learn, you know, not to do it. But if your mom's not on board, then it's a lost cause. It just is. Sometimes the best thing for children and their parents to do is you just don't talk about, like, you know, dog training tools. You know, if you were a vegan and they're not, and it's like, hey, mom, stop trying to push steak on me or I'm going to stop coming over your house. I mean, if there's certain things you got to do with your parents once you become an adult, you know, that it's just like boundaries. It's like, I'm going to stop coming over here, and it's going to probably hurt them more than hurt you. And it doesn't,
Come to that point almost.
Yeah. So, you know, you can, you know, write a letter to your parents. You can have a conversation, you know. You're an adult now. You're not, you know, I know you'll always be their child, but it's like, you know, like, stop, you know, I'm not 12 years old anymore, Ma. It's like, let's discuss this. So, and you can just stop going to their house if it gets to it. So the first thing I would do is I would get into a routine where you know, kennel up the dog in your bedroom. You have your own little life. And when it's family time, you might have to kennel up the dog. If you want to get them together, it's in the backyard. You might want to keep the pushy dog on a leash at the beginning. But the problem with that is if the dog pulls on the leash, it can agitate the dog. So it's a you know, you see us with dogs on leashes. That's because we know they're aggressive. We have to keep them on a leash. But we also make sure that leash is very, very slack. There's no tension on it whatsoever. As soon as you put tension on it, what you do is you create agitation. If you ever see a protection dog or a police dog or a military dog when they're at the end of the leash, at the beginning of it, it's done on prey drive. And what happens is the dog is just feeling the pressure. And that's why dogs pull on harnesses. That's why dogs pull on flat buckle collars, because they fight against it. And then you can just pop the dog with the prong collar. Remote collar would be great. Just dressage whip would be great. The thing is, it's a 1 or 2 second punisher in the course of like a day. So,
yeah.
But that's a conversation you're gonna have with your folks. If they're not on board, it's gonna be, you know, you're the ones that are gonna pay the price. You're the ones that are gonna have a leash reactive dog, you know?
Yeah. Because right now my puppy, it's a pitbull puppy, and he gets along with pretty much every dog. He gets along with people, so I don't really... The thing is, it's not my dog that's causing me these problems.
I know.
And they make it seem like it is my puppy, but he's not...
Well, that's... unfortunately, some people don't take 100% responsibilities, and they like to blame and shame. So, I mean, this is the thing, is the last thing you need is, you know, a pity being reactive. I mean, you just don't need it. And it's such an important, it's such an important time in the dog's life, age-wise, where it really doesn't need to be experiencing those things. It just doesn't. So you're going to have a conversation. You said you bring you and your girlfriend go over there, right?
Yeah, we go home to our family. So one day I'll have the puppy, and then another day she'll have the puppy at her house.
Okay. And,
yeah.
And she's not having the problems at her house?
I mean, there's a Cocker Spaniel there, but she doesn't really lunge, but she just barks at him. Like, she doesn't want him play near her or something like
that. You can stop that, too. So you can stop. I mean, everything can be stopped, but remember, you're shaping a dog's, you know, adulthood. Just think about it that way. You're introducing experiences. When it meets dogs, bad things happen. So just think about that throughout the course of, you know, a dog. And your dog's not even into adulthood. So you can have a dog that can have the best. I get these calls all the time. My dog's always been great with dogs. Fantastic with dogs. Oh my gosh, every dog it meets. Hits 18 months, 2 years old, it's the worst dog ever. And it's only had good experiences. So imagine what could happen with a dog that's been raised, that it's meeting dogs and it's having bad experiences. If that was my dog, I would either put the dog in the bedroom and then work it, or have a conversation with my folks. But if my folks were going to be objecting to all that, my dogs don't go there. So, because I'm going to be the one stuck with this dog, you know, 7 days a week.
Yeah. I know we have a few minutes left, so just one more thing. If I put a muzzle on the lab,
yep,
and then just let them go near each other, because I mean, I don't know if he would bite or not. That's my biggest issue. If he's just kind of like scaring him away to show dominance, then I kind of understand that because of territory. But with the muzzle, I'll feel 1,000 times safer knowing that he's not going to break my puppy's neck or anything like that.
But you still have to put a punisher in there. So, you know, if I'm walking down the street, I don't want to get hit, but I also don't want someone getting into my face yelling at me. I don't want either one, right? It's gonna skew how I feel about a certain, you know, whether it's human, it's just the way it is. Oh, humans are bad, or if, you know, so I don't even want the dog to do that. And that dog can still muzzle punch your puppy to cause injury. So muzzle punches hurt. The punisher still has to be there. You're still gonna have to punish that dog. He's gonna have to.
Yeah.
So
I think I'd be the one holding him on the leash, because I feel like my dad puts too much. I feel like he's resource guarding my dad or something, because he loves my dad, but everyone else in the family he doesn't give two shits about us.
All right. So you can try it with the muzzle will prevent a bite, but it does not prevent an injury. Just keep that in mind. So muzzle. I don't know if I've been muzzle punched before, and boy, does it hurt. So, and they can punch and punch and punch and punch and punch and punch because they get frustrated that they can't bite. And now your dog is getting, you know, again, your dog is getting it. Technically, your dog is being attacked. So I would still, you know, yes, that'll keep your dog from being bit, but it won't keep your dog from being injured, and it will never solve the problem.
Okay.
So, again, going back to step one, where it's like, I'm going to just have to keep my dog in my room. It's no big deal. I mean, you know, you do 3 hours in the course of a day, you exercise your dog will be fine. It's just a puppy.
Yeah.
It's a puppy. I mean, people think they have to have their dogs out, you know, 10, 12 hours a day, and they don't. And we're not talking about 7 days a week. We're talking about the weekend. So
it's one day.
Yeah. It's one day. Yeah. If it's one day, I'd even maybe try to come up with another alternative to even bringing the dog. But one day I would exercise my dog in the morning, go to the house, put it in your room, put it in a crate. 3-4 hours later, take it out, go for another walk around the block, come home, put it in the crate, find a park nearby, put the dog on a long line, let it run around, do some obedience, come home, put it in the crate. That's what I would do. And I would be like, yeah. Sorry, mom and dad, you're not ruining my dog. Just, yeah. So it's just, a, it's just, it, it, I, dogs and kids, you know, they're yours. It's a dictatorship. You get to decide how you raise them. Yeah. So, all right.
Yeah. All right, Jeff, I appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thanks for reaching out. I really appreciate it.
No problem. Have a good one.
Yep. You too. Bye-bye.